So now we continue with op-amp circuits, and now in this session we will talk about some circuits that involve non-linear operation of the op-amp. Okay. So we will first talk about precision rectifiers that you can make with op-amps. And to begin with, before we actually go to precision rectifiers, let us see, it is good to show the students as well what an ordinary diode can do as a rectifier. Okay, so let's just take a simple half-wave rectifier. So if this diode conducts, the VO is just VI minus some 0.7 volts or so, and that gives you the straight line with an intercept of about 0.7 volts, the turn-on voltage of this diode, and the slope of this line is 1, because it's just VO equal to VI minus 0.7. And when, of course, the VI is less than 0.7, then there is no conduction and then the output voltage is 0. So that is this particular line. Okay, so we are essentially coming to why we need improved circuits, and that will bring us to precision rectifiers using op-amps. So what is the problem with this circuit? The problem with this circuit is that if your VI is small, if the input voltage is, let's say, less than 0.7 volts, then at the output you are going to get only 0 volts. Okay, so that's the whole point of rectifying then is lost. You don't get any output, and that is a drawback of the simple diode rectifier, and that is indeed the motivation for using better circuits like called precision rectifier circuits, and these are made with op amps. All right, so let's go ahead and let's see what a simple precision rectifier will look like. Okay, so this is a circuit that is there in most textbooks. Okay, so the important thing is how do you go about analyzing this circuit? It's not trivial, and it is better to actually show them logically how things follow from one another, rather than just giving them the circuit and giving them the output-input relationship. That is the least satisfactory output. So let's just see how we can systematically consider these various cases and logically derive the output input characteristics. So what can happen to this diode? It can either conduct or it cannot conduct. These are the two possibilities, and it is best to take these two cases one by one and then see what happens to output voltage, what happens to the input voltage, and then combine the two cases. So first we will consider this case where the diode is conducting. What happens if the diode is conducting? If the diode is conducting, this feedback loop then gets closed, right? And the circuit actually is very similar to a buffer, except that this diode is there in the output circuit. But this diode is like just a constant voltage drop. So in that case, that sense, it's very similar to a buffer. Okay, so if that is the case, if it's like a buffer, the op-amp operates in the linear region, we can say that this V plus and V minus are more or less equal because the gain of the op-amp is very high. Okay, and the diode, if it is conducting, it is replaced by a constant voltage drop of VD, and that is what is shown over here. And of course, it's important to note that the diode current can only go in that direction from plus to minus. So the feedback loop is closed and the circuit looks like the buffer that we have seen earlier. So now let us see what more can we say. Okay, here it is. Since the input current is 0, that current is 0, current entering the minus the inverting terminal, we can say that this current IR here is the same as this current ID. So we can say that IR and ID are equal because the op-amp does not draw any current at the input. Okay. So what does it mean? What it means is, we already have this V plus and V minus, it's small. In this particular case, what happens to this 0.7 volts drop to the diode? So let us see that first. Okay, what is V plus minus V minus? It is VO1 by AV, where VO1 is this output voltage here. That divided by AV is the voltage gain of the op-amp, which is 10 raised to 5, very large. And what is VO1? VO1 is VO plus 0.7, third voltage drop. Okay, so that is VO1, VO plus 0.7. So your V plus minus V minus is VO1 by AV, which is VO plus 0.7 by AV. and that, because AV is very large, is 0 volts, right, or more or less 0 volts. What it means is that V plus and V minus are essentially at the same voltage, and VO therefore is equal to VI. All right. So all of this is logically derived from the fact that the diode is conducting, and that is the first case that we have considered. So what else can we say and about this case? What else can we say? It's here. Now, when does this situation arise? Okay, what we are talking about is there is this diode conducting, can only conduct in that forward direction, right? And all of that current goes through this resistor, and therefore VO, and so therefore the current through the resistor can only be positive, and therefore VO can only be positive. And because VO is equal to VI, VI can only be positive. So all of these conclusions we can draw simply from the fact that the diode is conducting. Okay, so that all of these considerations give us this particular part of the characteristics. That is, VI is positive, VO is positive, and VO is equal to VI. And therefore, we have a straight line going through the origin with a slope equal to 1. And it's important to point out that this 0.7 volts does not enter this figure at all, because it has got divided by AV, and therefore it has got reduced to 0. And that is why this is a much improved circuit as compared to the simple diode half wave rectifier. We are not done yet. We have only considered the first case. Now let's consider the second case when D is not conducting. Okay, that's in the next slide. Okay, so here we consider the second case where D is not conducting. When is D not conducting? For what condition at the input? So D is not conducting when the first case that we just considered is not happening. That means VI must now be less than 0. Okay, so if D is not conducting, the diode is essentially an open circuit, and now the op amp is in the open loop configuration. Okay, and if the op amp is in the open loop configuration, what do we say about VO? This, there is no current anywhere in the circuit, and there is no current therefore through the resistor, and therefore VO is equal to 0. And as we said earlier, this will happen when the first case does not happen, and the first case happened when VI was positive, so therefore this case happens when VI is negative, and therefore this particular consideration gives us this part of the VO VI characteristics. So now we put these things together. That is in the next slide. Okay. We put these things together and we get the complete VI characteristics, VO versus VI characteristics. All right. Okay, so VO is equal to VI, and this goes all the way through the origin. VO is 0 here. So this looks very much like the diode half wave rectifier, except now we have got rid of that VD drop, because as we saw in the previous slide, it got divided by AV. Okay, so this is really an ideal kind of situation where VO is equal to VI without any diode drop, and if VI is positive, and VO is 0 if VI is negative. In this part, the diode is conducting. In this part, diode is not conducting. So all that we concluded just on the basis of simple considerations about the diode conducting or not conducting. All right, let's look at some results. Okay, let me go back. So if I apply an input voltage, the blue one, I get an output voltage, which is, the red one is the input voltage VI, and the blue one is the output voltage. So the output voltage is equal to the input voltage in this half, and the output voltage is 0 in this half, okay, like that. Okay. This circuit is called a super diode, because it is like a diode, except that this VD equal to 0.7 has now disappeared, and it has been replaced by VD equal to 0. So it's like a diode with a 0 turn on voltage. Okay. So that's the nice thing about this circuit. Okay, what is this a good circuit? The answer is that it is good if it is, if the frequency is low, okay. And that is because if you look at this circuit, when this diode is not conducting, the op amp is in the open loop, and your VO, the op amp is going to get driven into saturation, and V plus and V minus are not going to be, V minus is going to be 0 in that part, and VI is going to be whatever VI you apply. So therefore, V plus and V minus are not going to be equal, and therefore that is going to drive the op amp into saturation. So that is what is shown here by this yellow line. When the op amp, when the diode is not conducting, this half of the cycle, the op amp actually saturates, the output voltage goes to minus Vsat. Okay. Now all this is okay if your frequencies are small. If your frequencies are large, like let's say 25 kilohertz, 50 kilohertz or whatever for a 741, then when the op amp goes into saturation, it will take some time to come out of saturation, and that will give rise to a waveform which is not quite what you expect, or slightly different. Okay. So that is therefore this circuit needs to be improved upon. So the op amp needs to come out of saturation when the input voltage changes from negative to positive values, and this is a relatively slow process, and it limits the speed of this circuit. So therefore there are better circuits which do not require the op amp to go into saturation. Let's see some of those, or at least one of those. Okay, so the way this circuit works, this is also a half wave rectifier. It's got two diodes. It's like this. Let's take the case where D1 conducts. So now these are some details that we actually should skip, because otherwise it will you have the slides, so go through it later. These are some details which show that if D1 is conducting, D2 cannot be conducting, and therefore the path of this current is like that. Okay, that is what happens if D1 is conducting. You can also show that, and it's all done here. You can also show that if D2 conducts, then D1 cannot conduct, and the path of the current is like that, as shown by the gray arrows. All right, so let's, for the moment, let's just assume that this is what happens, and you can see the explanation for this later. So if D1 conducts, we have this path, and if D2 conducts, we have this path. So clearly, if D1 is conducting, what can we say about the input voltage? The input voltage then is, the current is like this. This voltage is at 0 volts because there is a feedback path, and then the op amp is in the linear region. And the input voltage, this current can only go from this input into this inverting input, towards this inverting input, and therefore this VI can only be positive. So this situation applies when VI is positive. In this situation the current can only go in that direction from the inverting terminal towards VI. In that case, VI is necessarily less than 0. So we have two situations, VI greater than 0 where this happens, VI less than 0 where this happens. Now let us see how what it leads to. In this case, if VI is greater than 0, the path of the current is like this. There is no current in R2, and this output voltage is sitting at 0 volts. Okay. In this situation, the output current, there is a path here, and this is essentially like an inverting amplifier. You have 0 volts here, virtual ground, so therefore this current is VI by R1, and that same current is going like that, and therefore VO is this voltage plus this voltage drop, and that will give you R2 by R1 times VI. So if you do put all of these things together, you will get the characteristics that we have shown in the next figure. You will get something like this. Okay, so it is, the output is minus R2 by R1 times VI when D2 conducts, and is 0 if D1 conducts. And note that this is a little different than the earlier one, because in the earlier one we had 0 volts here, now we have 0 volts here in the positive side. But essentially there is a big difference between those, between the previous circuit and this circuit. and that is that the feedback loop is closed in both VI greater than 0 case and VI less than 0 case in this for this circuit, and therefore the op amp remains in the linear region. That's a big plus over the last circuit. Okay. In fact, we have some simulation results which will confirm that. So let us just show that simulation result. Okay. So this plot shows the red one is VI, the blue one is VO. So if VI is positive, VO is 0. If VI is negative, VO is minus VI. So it is doing half wave rectification. And VO1, the output of the op amp, is always small voltage. VO1 here it is about 1.5 volts, and in the negative it is about minus 0.5 volts. So the op amp does not enter saturation in this with this particular circuit, and that's because the feedback path is closed either through D1 or through D2. So there's definitely a big plus as far as speed is concerned, because if the op amp is not entering saturation, then your circuit will be faster. If it does not enter saturation, it does not have to come out of saturation, and therefore the speed of the circuit can be higher than the previous one. Okay. Now, if you have looked at SQL distribution, there is a file called precision half wave, and you can actually run and get these results. You can run that same file and get these results. Okay. Improved half wave precision rectifier continued. This is a similar circuit. The difference is that the direction of the diodes is now reversed, and then what you get is you can analyze this circuit, and then you get something like this. VO is 0 here, and VO is minus R2 by R1 times VI in this region. Okay. Now it's good to talk about some application at this point, because we have considered a very important circuit, and that's a rectifier, half wave rectifier, and that's a precision rectifier. That means it can amplify voltages which are rather small, which are even less than 0.7 volts, which we cannot do, which we cannot rectify with the simple diode resistor rectifier circuit. Okay, so what is being shown here is this is the super diode. That is a circuit that we just discussed. It's an op amp, and there is an R resistive load, and then that is there is a capacitor. So this is essentially like the diode half wave rectifier with a capacitor filter. Okay, that is what this is. And this diode is not a simple diode, but it is the improved diode which we have just discussed, which will have an op amp. So if you do that, then this will start rectifying at 0 volts and not at 0.7 volts, and then therefore you can actually use this to trace the envelope of this particular signal. And this is an application where the AM signal, the signal shown in light blue is the amplitude modulated signal. The signal shown in dark blue is the demodulated signal, the output of this circuit. So this is an application where we have demodulation of even small voltages, which is you see that the amplitude here is just 100 millivolts or so, or 150 millivolts, which is much smaller than the 0.7 volts that an ordinary diode would turn on at. So therefore, this circuit is much better than the half wave diode rectifier, and we get by demodulation this envelope of the AM signal. You can play with this circuit. For example, it's very important to tell the students at this point that this value of the capacitor is very important. If the capacitor value is too small, what will happen is it will discharge too fast, and it will have the ripple here will increase. If the value of the capacitor is too large, what will happen is it will stay constant, it will not drop at all, and then this at this point it will just remain constant and will lose out all this information. So therefore, it's a very good exercise for students to do. Just play with this value of the capacitor and see what happens to the demodulated waveform. And of course, once this demodulation is done, we need to pass this through a filter so that the little ripple over here is removed, and you get the original signal back. Okay, so that's an application for a half wave rectifier. Okay, to continue further, let's talk about a full wave precision rectifier. Okay. This is a full wave rectifier. It is best illustrated in terms of a block diagram. Okay, so for example, if this is the input voltage, there is a half wave rectifier which is inverting. So at VO1, you will get this kind of waveform. This one, I am simply multiplying it by minus 1, and therefore at this point VB, I will get VB versus VI like that. And to get a waveform like this, to get a VO versus VI transfer characteristics like this, which is the full wave rectifier, what we need to do is we need to multiply this by minus 2 to get this particular characteristics, VA versus VI, and then we add this VA here and VB here, and then if you add these two, you will see that this slope will be minus 1 and this slope will be plus 1. Okay. So that is a block diagram of how you can generate this full wave rectifier, and this is the actual simulation result. So that is the input voltage and that is the output voltage. Now how do you do all these things? We already looked at this inverting half wave rectifier in this circuit in the previous slide, and that is that goes in this block. Then how do you multiply something by minus 2? That we can do by summer. So this block is serving as summing this voltage directly as well as this voltage with a sign of minus with a negative sign. And so all of this is being implemented by just two op amps. One op amp serving as the inverting half wave rectifier, and then another one serving as an inverting summer. Note that these resistor values are different. Here we have R, that is to give you a slope of 1 here, that is R by R here, and they have R by 2 here, that will give you the slope of 2. Okay. So then you get these, and it is being added, and then finally at the output you will get this kind of characteristics. So this is called a precision full wave rectifier. Why precision? Because we have got rid of this 0.7 volts diode drop. It will this will actually go to 0, not 0.7. Okay, let's continue further. Okay, maybe let us just consider this particular one because it has got a very nice interesting application: wave shaping with diodes. Okay. All right, let's take a very simple circuit like this with a single diode. Resistor R here, R prime here, R0 here. 0 volts here, minus V0 here. This is a constant voltage, a negative voltage. And if you do analyze the circuits, consider two cases, D off and D on, and we can take an on voltage of 0.7 volts or something. If you do this, you will get a V versus I, where I is this current, okay. I is this current here, and V is this voltage at this point. And why are we plotting things with respect to I? That will become clear later. So if I get V, if I plot V versus I get for these two different conditions, I get two different curves, right? And that is what a V versus I looks like. And how we got this, we should actually go through all these details and figure that out. It's very interesting. Okay, next slide. Okay, now this. Okay, I would. There is actually a problem with this viewer here, so I cannot keep adding these things without disturbing this. We cannot view the whole thing and still add things. So therefore, what I will say is you can go through this slides later and see how this fits into the previous one. Let us just show the final result. So what this, so this circuit is essentially composed of individual blocks that we have just discussed, and you can see that the block that we discussed, that is one resistor, another resistor, and then there is a diode, that is repeated 4 times, and each time you do that, you introduce a break in this V versus I curve, right? And eventually what we do is we put this whole network in the feedback path of this inverting amplifier. And as a result, you get you get this kind of characteristics for VO versus VI. And if now if I apply a triangle at the input, I get a reasonable approximation for a sine. So this is a triangle to sine wave converter. So this kind of circuit illustrates both diodes and op-amp circuits. Okay. So if you notice, we are in the diode in the precision rectifiers, we had one circuit in which the op-amp went into saturation, but in the other circuits, the op-amp actually did not go into saturation, and that was an advantage because then that those circuits are faster in which the op-amp remains in the linear region. So let's now look at some other circuits, and in these circuits, the op-amp will go into saturation, and let's see some of these circuits as well. Okay, now this of course is a very important circuit, that is the Schmitt trigger, and let us see how, in fact a Schmitt trigger is not very different than an inverting amplifier, it is just a simple change of sign, plus minus. Okay, and it, to explain that in class in to first year or second year students is not easy, but here is a qualitative way of doing that. So let us just take the inverting amplifier. Essentially what happens is, if I switch this plus and minus, the feedback actually becomes positive, and therefore this inverting amplifier fails to work as an inverting amplifier, and as you know, it works as a Schmitt trigger, which is useful in other ways but not as an inverting amplifier. So let us just qualitatively show that this first circuit has negative feedback in it. Okay, how do we go about doing that? So let's start with an ideal equation. VO, the output voltage here of the op-amp, is given by the gain of this op-amp, AV, multiplied by V plus minus V minus. Okay, let's call that equation 1. Now, since the op-amp has a high input resistance, this current and this current are the same, and of course, this we have seen before, and we get, what do we get then? This is VI, this is VO, and you can write the, you can get the expression for this current as VI minus VO by R1 plus R2, and then you can get this voltage at V minus. So V minus is VI times R2 by R1 plus R2 plus VO by R1 plus R2. Okay, so let's call that equation 2. Right. Now let's just try to understand qualitatively why this feedback is considered negative. So let's say your VI increases. What happens as a result? As a result of VI increasing, look at equation 2. Okay, if VI increases, your V minus is going to increase as shown here. What happens if V minus increases? If V minus increases, VO is going to decrease because this V minus has come with a negative sign. So if VO is, so therefore the output voltage is going to decrease, and that is because of equation 1. If VO is if VO decreases, what happens to V minus? V minus will decrease from equation 2, right? So if VI is increasing, there is one trend here for V minus to increase, but there is another trend here for V minus to decrease. And if you look at these two boxes, you see that this feedback is negative. And therefore, what happens in practice is, of course, all of these things are, it's not as if there is a time delay between this process, all of this thing is happening together, and the circuit reaches a stable output voltage. And then you can, the circuit reaches a stable equilibrium, so to say, and then we can actually perform the analysis assuming that the op-amp is in the linear region. If we interchange these two terminals, then the situation is very, very different as shown here. Okay, what happens if I make this the plus terminal and that, sorry, I don't have the pointer. What happens if I make this the plus terminal and this the minus terminal? Then everything actually changes. Let us see how. So now what we have is, again we will say that this current is small because that's an input current of the op amp, and there is a base of a transistor there which will draw a small current. So we can say that this V plus is now given by Vi minus this voltage drop, and then this voltage drop can be found once you know this current. What is this current? Vi minus Vo divided by R1 plus R2. Putting all of that together, you get V plus equal to Vi times R2 by R1 plus R2 plus Vo times R1 by R1 plus R2. All right, and this equation of course still holds because it holds for both these cases. Now what happens? Vi increases. If Vi increases, my V plus is going to increase because of this term, because of equation 3. If V plus increases, go back to this equation 1, if V plus increases, Vo is going to increase. So Vo is going to increase. If Vo increases, now go back to this equation. Okay, this Vo is coming with a plus sign, so if Vo increases, V plus also increases, and that is what is shown over here. So in other words, if as a change in Vi, I have an upward trend in V plus here, and upward trend here again in V plus. So therefore, the feedback is positive. Here the trend was opposite. Here I had an upward trend here, but a downward trend here. So therefore, this was negative feedback. This is positive feedback, and therefore, what happens in such a circuit is it does not reach any stable output value, but the op amp will simply enter saturation. So we now have a positive feedback situation. As a result, the output voltage will rise or fall indefinitely. So it will either hit plus Vsat or it will hit minus Vsat, and finally this output voltage gets limited by saturation. Okay. So it's very important to explain to the students how these two circuits are so similar in terms of the configuration, but still so different in terms of operation. They are completely different. This is an amplifier and this is a comparator, a Schmidt comparator. Same thing goes with a non-inverting amplifier. This is our old friend, the non-inverting amplifier, and here what we have done is the plus and minus are interchanged, and now we get a completely different circuit, and as we know, this is also a Schmidt trigger, although a different kind of Schmidt trigger than the previous one. So here again we can show that the feedback in this case is negative, in this case is positive. So let us see how. So this equation of course still holds. The output voltage is given by the gain of the op amp times V plus minus V minus. Now the other equation is a little different here. So this output voltage is Vo, and there is no current being drawn at this terminal. So therefore the V minus is simply going to be the output voltage times R1 by R1 plus R2. Okay, so now let us see what happens if I make a slight change in Vi. If I change Vi, what happens to Vi is the same as V plus. Okay, so let's say I increase Vi, that's the same thing as increasing V plus, and therefore Vo will increase, and that is what is shown over here. If Vo increases, what happens to Vi? That will also increase because of equation 2, and that is what is shown over here. If V minus increases, go back to equation 1. If V minus increases, Vo is going to decrease because of this negative sign. Okay, and that is what is shown over here. So again, you see an upward trend here in some quantity and a downward trend here in the same quantity, and therefore the feedback is negative. The circuit will reach a stable equilibrium, and therefore the analysis that we did, assuming linear region, is fine. And then you can derive the expression for the output voltage in terms of the input voltage. In this situation, looks very similar, but now plus and minus are interchanged. So the this equation 1 still holds. Equation 2 is now replaced by V plus being equal to Vo times R1 by R1 plus R2. Okay, now let us see what happens. If Vi increases, your output voltage is going to decrease because Vi is now the same as V minus. So if V minus increases, the output voltage is going to decrease because of this negative sign. That is what is shown here. If Vo decreases, what happens to V plus? V plus will also decrease. Right? If V plus decreases, what will happen to Vo? Vo will decrease. Okay. Now we have the same trend here. Vo going down, Vo going down, and therefore this is a positive feedback situation. Again, as in the previous case, this circuit will the output will just keep increasing either towards Vset or minus Vset, and then finally we'll, the op amp will enter saturation. So in these kinds of circuits which are unstable, the output of the op amp is not going to be between Vset and minus or minus. It's going to be at Vset or minus Vset and not anywhere in between because of the unstable nature of this circuit. And that's very important to clarify. So it's very, very important to clarify in class that these circuits are, they are seemingly very similar in terms of configuration, but in terms of operation, they are vastly different. Okay, let's go to the next slide. Okay, so this, both of these things actually are Schmitt triggers, as we already know. You must be teaching these things in class, and they are nothing but the inverting and non-inverting amplifiers with the plus minus interchanged. So this is an inverting amplifier with plus minus interchanged. This is a non-inverting amplifier with plus minus interchanged. Because of positive feedback, both of these circuits are unstable. The output at any time is only limited by saturation of the op amp. That is, the output will only be either plus Vset or minus Vset. All right, now the important question is, of what use is a circuit that is stuck at either plus Vset or minus Vset? That is an important question that comes to mind. And of course, as we know this, it turns out that these circuits are actually useful, and we know that we can make oscillators with these, and we will actually see examples of that. But before we do that, let us see what it does. Okay, so it is best to take some specific numbers and work out the VO versus VI characteristics in all of these things. Okay, so in this, what we have done is we have taken this inverting Schmitt trigger. So it is the same as the positive, the non-inverting amplifier with plus minus interchanged, and it turns out to be an inverting Schmitt trigger. So where do we begin with such a circuit? We begin with, let's say, a high input voltage. In particular, I have taken an example of 5 volts. So let's say this is 5 volts, and at 5 volts, let us see what the output is. And this can be done by just taking some, considering some cases. And what do we know about this circuit? We know that the output voltage can be either at plus Vset or minus Vset, and that's all. It doesn't have any other option but to be at either of these values. Okay, so let's suppose as the first case, I take VO is equal to plus Vset. So what the situation now is, this is 5 volts, this is 10 volts, I have taken Vset as 10 volts here. So this is 5 volts and this is 10 volts, and let us see if that is possible. If this is 10 volts, there is a 9K here, there is a 1K here, so this is going to be at 1 volt, okay. So the situation is like this, there is a 1 volt here at plus, 5 volts here at minus, and the output we have assumed to be plus 10, and we see that is actually not possible. If this is 5 and this is 1, then the output cannot be plus Vset, it will only be minus Vset. So therefore, it's very easy to show that this first case is actually inconsistent with our assumption of VO being plus Vset. So therefore, what the other option, which is VO equal to minus Vset, and that turns out to be consistent, and you can show that. And therefore, we have at least one point in the VO versus VI plane to start with. And what is that point? That point is VO is, so VI is 5 volts right here, and VO is minus 10, that is minus Vsat, okay. Now it's important actually to look at this voltage, that is playing a very crucial role in all of this operation. So if this is minus 10 volts, this is going to be simply by voltage division 1 over 10 times the output voltage, that is minus 1 volt, okay. So we have one data point in this whole transfer characteristics, VO versus VI, and that is input voltage is 5 volts, output voltage is minus 10, and this V plus is minus 1 volt, okay. So let's take this further. Now you can always say in class that, okay, this is a non-inverting Schmitt trigger and this is what its characteristics looks like, and etc. But if you derive this logically, the student is much more satisfied with the analysis, and that is why we are doing all this. Okay, and you can actually show that if you increase VO, if increase VI from 5 to 10, the same situation actually will apply. VO will continue to be minus VSAT, V plus will continue to be minus 1 volt. Okay, so that is that. Now the important question is what happens when you come back? Okay, and that is where, so that is the next slide. So we have already got up to this point. Now what happens if we come back? Okay, so let's just take it up to here right now. What happens if I go on decreasing the input voltage? Okay, now this is at this point it's very crucial to know what is going on at V plus, right? So V plus because of voltage division is going to be R1 over R1 plus R2 times VO, and that is as long as this output voltage is minus 10 volts, this V plus is going to be minus 1 volt, right? So as now as long as your VI is actually larger than minus 1 volt, there is no difference. The circuit remains in this particular state, but if I cross this minus 1 volt, then things change. Then what happens is the output is going to switch from minus VSAT to plus VSAT, and that is what is being shown here. Okay, it's very important to sort of derive these things systematically so that the student actually understands. This will lead to a much deeper understanding of this circuit. So as soon as your input voltage crosses minus 1 volt, the output is going to switch to plus VSAT, and then it's easy to show that it actually is going to stay there. Once it switches to plus VSAT, V plus now becomes plus 1 volt, and if you are, so V plus is now sitting at plus 1 volt. This is plus 1 volt, and now if your input, if you decrease it further like in this direction, okay, it's always going to be smaller than this plus 1 volt here, and therefore your output is always going to be at plus VSAT. So we can complete that part of the characteristics. Okay, what happens now if you come back? If you come back, now your V plus is sitting at plus 1 volt, and therefore the transition will only happen when you cross plus 1 volt at this point, and that in fact will complete your characteristics. Okay, so that is the complete characteristics. It can be systematically and logically explained, you know, just from the basics, rather than just giving this circuit and giving this figure in class. It makes much better sense to actually explain why it is like that. Okay, so this is our VO versus VI characteristics, and it is equally important to also talk about V plus here, right? So V plus at any stage is simply given by voltage division, and therefore it is actually proportional to VO. If VO becomes plus 10 volts, V plus becomes plus 1 volt. VO becomes plus 10, V plus becomes plus 1. VO becomes minus 10, V plus becomes minus 1. And there is a simple proportionality factor of R1 over R1 plus R2, which is the voltage division. Okay, so that is how this we would call the inverting Schmitt trigger, because if your input voltage is positive, large positive, then your output voltage is negative. The input voltage is negative, the output voltage is positive. Therefore, we call this the inverting Schmitt trigger. Next slide. Okay. So before we go to the non-inverting Schmitt trigger, it is important to define a few things, and these things are called, these values here, the input voltage here at which this transition occurs is called the threshold voltage, high, VTH. This point is called threshold voltage, low. Some people call this the tipping points or the threshold points. And as we have seen, this is simply given by plus minus. This is given by plus R1 by R1 plus R2 times VO, and this one is given by minus R1 by R1 plus R2 times VSAT. Okay, and this width between these two, VTH and VTL, is called the hysteresis width. And what is unusual about this circuit as compared to amplifiers and so on, that the tipping point will really depend on where we are on the VO versus VI axis. In that sense, this circuit has memory. For example, if I tell you that this input voltage is 0 volts, you will not be able to tell me whether the output voltage is 10 volts or minus 10 volts, because it will depend on whether we came from here or whether we came from here. Right? So in that sense, this circuit has as memory, and that's all very crucial in understanding the operation of the circuits which are based on this Schmitt trigger. Let's look at the non-inverting Schmitt trigger, and the reason, and in some ways it is similar, but in one important way it is sort of very different than the inverting case, and therefore it's worthwhile going through this. Okay, so in this case, once again, we can start off as we can start off at one data point. Let's say we apply 5 volts, and we can actually show that this the circuit cannot be at minus Vsat; it can only be at plus Vsat, and that gives us this initial data point. So the V input is 5 volts, the output voltage is 10 volts, that is Vsat. I have taken Vsat as a good round number of 10 volts for simplicity, and then V plus, and that is where the difference between this circuit and the previous circuit comes. What is V plus here? V plus actually will now depend both on Vi as well as Vo. In the previous case, V plus or the threshold point depended only on the output voltage. Here, the input voltage as well as the output voltage is going to influence the voltage at this point. And how is it going to affect that? That is going to affect it like this. Okay, V plus is R2 by R1 plus R2 times Vi plus R1 by R1 plus R2 times Vo. Okay, so if we do this, it turns out that this case 1, in which we assume that minus Vsat, Vo is minus Vsat or minus 10 volts, is ruled out, and it turns out that the other case, that Vo is plus Vsat, is actually consistent, and therefore that is the data point that we talked about here, that data point. Okay, what happens if we move to the right, increasing Vi? Let us see what happens to this voltage. Right. So let's look at this equation. This V plus depends on Vi and also on Vo. Now Vo is plus 10 volts, that is fixed. So this number is fixed, and Vi you are increasing, right? You are increasing Vi from 5 volts onwards. So this term is going to be larger and larger. So as a result, what is going to happen to V plus is it's going to increase, and it is at this point it is already some more than 5 volts, and it's only going to be larger than 5 volts. What is V minus in all of these cases? V minus is always at 0, and therefore V plus minus V minus is going to be positive, and therefore Vo is going to remain at Vsat. Okay, and that is what happens. So let's just show this part. Okay, so if I keep increasing V input, Vo will remain at Vsat, and then V plus also increases because of this dependence that we just looked at. And now the important thing is to come back and see what happens. So at some point, my input voltage is going to cross. At some point, this V plus is going to cross 0, and that is the point where the output voltage is going to switch to minus 10. All right, so that is the next slide. Okay. Alright, so now what we are doing is we are going in this negative direction. Okay, as a result, if you are decreasing Vi, your V plus is also going to decrease, and at some point this positive influence of Vo equal to plus 10 is going to be compensated by this negative influence of Vi, and that is, and this V plus is therefore going to cross 0 volts, and that is happening at, we are now approaching that point here. So beyond this point, this Vo is going to switch to minus 10 volts. So let's see what that looks like. And the rest of them, of course, are just details. Like this R2 by R1 plus R2 in this case is 9 by 10 Vi. R1 by R1 plus R2 is 1 by 10 Vo. Okay, so let's see what that does. Okay, so that is what happens there. Okay. So when V plus crosses 0, Vo is going to change. Once Vo changes, what will happen to this equation? Vo is now negative. So now this term is going to be negative. It was, and this was positive in this region, and now it is going to be negative. Okay. So what happens if I increase, if I decrease Vi further or increase it in the negative direction? If I do that, this term is already negative because my Vo is negative, minus 10 volts. This Vi is also negative, and therefore V plus is going to continue to be negative. If V plus is negative, my output voltage is going to be minus Vz, and that is what is shown over here. So now the important, the interesting part is what happens if I come back. If I come back, there is at some point, at some positive value of Vi, this is going to be more positive than this negative term, and then there is going to be a flipping again of the output voltage. Okay, and that is what this is. All right. So the, all of these arrows, etc., have definite meaning. And so this figure and the previous one looks actually, they look pretty similar, except that this is non-inverting. That one was inverting. But the other big difference here is that this V plus here actually changes. It is not constant because it does depend on the input voltage. And these are things that you actually can observe when you do the lab today. It's today or tomorrow. Whenever you do the lab on a Schmitt trigger, you should actually look at the oscillator, look at Vi on the x-axis and Vo on the y-axis, also V plus on the y-axis, and see what you get over there. Okay. To do that, you will have to connect your Vi, the input voltage, to the x channel, that is channel 1, Vo to channel 2, or V plus to channel 2, as whichever you want to see, and then put the oscilloscope in the xy mode, then you will see these figures. Okay, non-inverting Schmitt trigger. So just some salient points about this non-inverting Schmitt trigger. Okay, what the threshold voltage values here are going to be are given by plus minus R1 over R2 times Vsat, and this you can derive from the condition that when V plus crosses 0, the output changes. And one of them will give you VTH, the other one will give you VTL. The second point is actually common to the inverting and non-inverting Schmitt triggers. As in the inverting Schmitt trigger, this circuit also has a memory because of this hysteresis here. For example, if I ask you what is the output voltage at 0 volts, it is you cannot tell me whether it is plus 10 or minus 10 because it will depend on whether you came like this or whether you came like this. Okay, so that is the memory effect. Again, it has a hysteresis width, which is given by VTH minus VTL. So these two circuits are basically pretty similar, except one is inverting, the other one is non-inverting. Okay. Now, what use are these Schmitt triggers? So before we do that, let us just summarize this. So there are two types of Schmitt triggers. And it is actually always good to show these things on the same slide, or if you are using a blackboard at the same time, because they are so similar, and they are also so similar to the inverting amplifier and non-inverting amplifier. So for example, this inverting, so this is the inverting Schmitt trigger. It is very similar to the non-inverting amplifier with plus minus interchanged, right? This is the non-inverting Schmitt trigger, but it is very similar to the inverting amplifier with plus minus interchange. So it is good to show this slide where all of these things are together, so that this, it just becomes a little easier for the student to remember what is what. Okay, now what use is this Schmitt trigger circuit? That can be explained by this slide. Let's look at this in detail. So we should talk about comparators. Let's take a comparator, and a simple op amp can act as a comparator because it has a very high gain. And if your V plus is even slightly higher than V minus, you're going to get plus Vsat. If your V plus is going to be slightly lower than V minus, you're going to get minus Vsat. And that is what a comparator does. It gives you a positive output for one condition and negative output for another. So all this is fine. and what is the motivation for using a Schmidt comparator as opposed to, and that is in the next slide. Alright, so this slide explains why you want to use a Schmidt trigger. Okay, so here is an analog signal, right, as applied to a simple op amp as a comparator. So if the input voltage goes above 0, the output voltage is high. If the input voltage goes below 0, the output voltage is low. And so this is what you would expect from this circuit. All this is fine, but in practice there are problems, and that is because of noise. So let us see what happens if you have noise on this circuit, noise on the input. Okay, so this is what happens if you have some noise on your input signal. So this is your original input. The actual input will not be as clean as this because there is a pickup and there is noise and so on. So in the actual input signal, you will have some distortions, and I have shown this as some disturbance riding over the input voltage. And if the distortion is such that this crosses 0 more than once, then you are in then we are in trouble. For example, here, just look at this one. It's not very clear in this picture, but if I expand this part, then you see that this input voltage is actually crossing 0 3 times. It is supposed to cross only once, but it is actually crossing and then crossing back and then crossing again, right? And if you do that, if you feed this to a comparator, you're going to get one state here, another state here, another state here, another state here. So instead of counting, instead of making one transition, we now have 1, 2, and 3 transitions. So this, there is one extra spurious pulse that we are getting. And suppose you are feeding this to a counter, that counter is going to erroneously count an extra count. So that is not desirable, and this happens because there are these spurious pickups and noise signals on top of your input voltage. A Schmidt trigger can be used to eliminate this so-called comparator chatter, and let us see in next slide to do that. So. Okay, now the same signal with in the presence of some disturbance is now fed to a comparator, which is a Schmidt comparator, or the non-inverting Schmidt trigger that we just saw. And what does that do? So to see that, what we do is, so this is the expanded view of this particular part which was giving us trouble. Same thing here. So it is crossing 0 twice. And the ordinary comparator actually gave us 2, 3 transitions here. Now let us see what the Schmidt trigger does. Okay. So in order to see that, what we do is we have, this is your input voltage. This axis is your time, and this is your input voltage. Okay. So let me plot input voltage on this axis and the output voltage on this axis. So if the input voltage is large and positive, the output voltage is plus Vsat. If the input voltage is large and negative, the output voltage is minus Vsat. And in between, we have this hysteresis. So now my input is now coming like that. Okay. And in this figure, what's happening is my input is coming like that. And the relevant transition is not the first one, but the second one. So if my input crosses this value, then my output is going to change. So in this figure, the input has to cross this VTL value for the output to change. Okay. And once I am in that region, and now the relevant threshold is this value here, VTH. Okay. So now unless the input actually goes above this, there is going to be no spurious transition. So beyond this point, my output is going to be going to remain low, and therefore now instead of counting 3 transitions, I count only 1 transition as we would like. So this is how a Schmidt trigger will help you to will serve as a better comparator than an ordinary comparator.